This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
إلى ما لا يقل عن 32 قتيلا وأكثر من 100 جريح.
The death toll of the latest suicide bomb attack that rocked the suburb of Peshawar has risen to 32. In addition, more than 100 people were wounded in the blast. So far, no group has claimed responsibility for the attack. However, the Pakistani authorities held the Pakistan Taliban group responsible for the blast. The Taliban has vowed to launch fierce guerrilla warfare against the Pakistani army. Meanwhile, the Pakistani army continues its offensive, dubbed the Path to Salvation, for the fourth consecutive week in southern Waziristan. Mayoub Khudar reports from Islamabad.
في تقرير زميلنا مهيوب خضر من إسلامباد.
سيناريو مذبحة سوق مينا يكرر.
The massacre of Nina Market has repeated itself in less than 2 weeks. This news comes after a powerful explosion rocked the busy Tarazdam Market in the heart of Peshawar, killing several civilians and injuring many others. According to the Pakistani police and government sources, the attack was carried out by a suicide bomber. Pakistani authorities held the Taliban responsible for the attack.
They are targeting civilians and public places because they are becoming desperate and unable to target Pakistani officials. I can assure you that this network of terror is coming to an end. The Taliban is targeting civilians because of their support for the government.
The government, as usual, has blamed the Taliban. On the other hand, the Taliban has denied any responsibility and confirmed that civilians are not their intended targets. These conflicting positions have opened the door to controversy regarding the identity of the attackers, who are seeking to shake the country's stability and disrupt its national security.
I am sure that there are other groups besides the Taliban that are responsible for the recent violence in the country. It appears that other foreign elements and anti-Pakistani groups are threatening the security situation in the country.
Meanwhile, the Pakistani army continues to push deep into Waziristan in an attempt to capture prominent Taliban leaders. The government is saying that their capture will help bring the war to an end. The Pakistani army's path to salvation has been going on for 25 days and continues to advance in the region of Waziristan. However, this military operation has not reaped its benefits, not even inside Pakistani cities. On the contrary, these cities have been turned into battlefields. Mahyoub Khudair, Dubai TV, Islamabad.
U.S. forces in Afghanistan said that they have discovered the body of an American soldier in a local river. The U.S. soldier, along with one of his comrades, went missing while they were on a military mission in western Afghanistan. U.S. forces have said that they are still searching for the other missing soldier alongside Afghan forces.
In another development, U.S. soldiers have carried out a raid on a home and killed its owner in the province of Kandahar in southern Afghanistan on suspicion that he is affiliated with the Taliban. There has been a recent surge in attacks on Afghan civilians. For the first time, some are talking about the withdrawal of foreign forces from Afghanistan in accordance with provisions leading to the transfer of security responsibilities to the Afghan forces.
Our correspondent Abdul Rahman Matar has the details in the following report.
Troops from the international forces are continuing to carry out home raids against residents allegedly linked with the Taliban. These images, which were captured in the city of Kandahar in southern Afghanistan, show the degree of brutality inflicted on anyone trying to defend their beliefs or stop the intruders from entering their homes.
The government must provide security for its people. We reject this daily intrusion in our homes and the killing of civilians. How can we allow foreigners, regardless of their affiliation, to enter our homes, which have women and children?
محاولة التقرب من المدنيين في قندهار لم تكن سهلة.
Rapprochement efforts by the troops from the U.S. Brigade in Kandahar were not an easy task because of the civilians' fears and especially their children's fears of these heavily armed soldiers.
من جنود مدججين بسلاح.
Everything we do is being done in cooperation with the Afghan police. We are seeking to improve the performance of the police in order to provide the highest level of security in Kandahar. The city is currently secure, as you can see. We can walk freely in the streets. However, I don't know about the security developments in the future, especially those pertaining to the issue of the withdrawal.
The issue of the withdrawal of the foreign forces from Afghanistan has cast its shadow on the Afghan capital of Kabul. The withdrawal comes in the context of the so-called transfer of security responsibilities. Foreign forces have been reluctant to give a specific timetable for their withdrawal or for the transfer of security responsibilities. The issue is being linked to the ability of the Afghan authorities to provide protection for the people. However, the position of Afghan officials was clear regarding the withdrawal issue.
Our agreement with the international community calls for the increase of the number of police and armed forces. I believe it is possible to have a gradual transfer of authority in the entire country through the handover of security responsibilities within 4 years.
The nature of the relations between the Afghan people and the soldiers of the foreign forces seems to be complicated or indifferent, to say the least. At the official level, the relationship is tolerated and accepted, but the picture is very different at the public level. Abdulrahman Matar, Al Jazeera, Kabul.
Joining us from Kabul is Najib Manali, advisor to the Afghan Minister of Finance.
Mr. Najib, the violations of the international forces against the Afghan civilians continue to go on day by day. This is being linked to recent talks about the withdrawal of the international forces and the transfer of the security responsibilities over to the Afghans. Is there a real connection?
Well, it's not exactly
linked. It's not exactly a connection. However, the Afghans have preconditioned the transfer of security responsibilities with the security improvement on the ground. This has been their demand for years. The Afghan people believe the only way to avoid these types of bad practices is to allow the Afghans to take part in the security operations. The Afghans know their land, their people, and their culture better than the foreign troops, so they can deal with this and help the coalition forces.
في خبر آخر، أعلن مسؤولون أمريكيون على صلة بالتحقيقات الجارية بشأن عملية إطلاق النار في قاعدة.
American officials have announced that Army Major Nidal Malik Hassan will be tried in a military court to face charges brought against him. The Imam of Dar al-Hijra Mosque, where Hassan went to pray, said that he does not know if Hassan has had any contact with men who incite terrorism.
مع رجال دين يحرضون على الإرهاب.
في هذا المسجد صلى الرائد الفلسطيني الأمريكي.
American Major Nidal Hassan prayed at this mosque. It is suspected that he was in contact with one of the former imams here, Ayman al-Aluki, who is under investigation and suspected of having links to terrorist groups. However, these accusations are only suspicions.
As we understand it, we do not have information linking al-Awlaki to Major Hassan, not to our knowledge.
مسؤول أمريكي غير مخول بالإفصاح عن
An American official who does not have the authority to disclose any information pertaining to the ongoing investigation pointed out that news reports are claiming that emails were exchanged between Major Hassan and Imam Anwar al-Awlaki. The Imam has praised the actions of the Muslim American officer on his website. The investigators are preoccupied with searching Hassan's electronic files for any evidence that proves that his attack was premeditated. A spokesperson for the hospital where Major Hassan is being treated has said that he is now able to talk, but it is unclear if his condition is stable enough to handle questioning.
كانت حالته تسمح للمحققين بإخضاعه للاستجواب.
The essential thing is that I would like to meet my client. I've advised military officials not to conduct meetings with him or have him undergo investigations by law enforcement personnel.
Law enforcement.
Preparations are ongoing at Fort Hood military base for the memorial ceremony to honor the 13 soldiers who were killed by the bullets fired by Major Nidal Hassan. American authorities believe that he is the only suspect so far, and high-level security measures have been implemented at the military base in Texas.
The added benefit, of course, is the symbolic gesture of having the U.S. President join us. This shows the importance of our mission at Fort Hood, as well as the mission of our families and of the families of the soldiers who lost their lives.
Fort Hood
officials have said that the largest military base in the country will continue its operations, although investigators have erected a security perimeter at the scene. Another building is temporarily being used to take care of business. Meanwhile, the country is holding its breath, fearing that similar events would take place again due to the growing opposition of Americans against the war. Mahed Abu Zaid, BBC.
The specter of displacement still lurks around tens of thousands of Palestinian children and their families living in high-risk areas. A field study completed by the international organization Save the Children concluded that the majority of Palestinian residents of these areas have been subjected to forced displacement at least once since the year 2000, as a result of the Israeli policy of land confiscation to make way for the separation wall and the settlements.
The children of Sosia dream about returning home, and their only wish is to receive basic children's rights in education and health. In 2000, the children and their families were forcibly uprooted from the village of Yatta, south of Hebron. A tent instead of a home, and livestock as a means for transport, is the kind of life that was imposed on them because they held on to the land of their grandparents, fearing that it will be confiscated by the Israeli settlement of Sosia. And even though this region is under the control of the Israeli authorities, the children here don't receive their most basic rights.
We have a television and we see the incidents that take place, but we don't have sufficient electricity.
I wish that one day we will have electricity and water and televisions just like the people in Yatta do.
In 1948, the grandparents of this family were forced to migrate from their land situated within the confines of the Green Line. Their land has been transformed into a training camp for the Israeli army. They came to Sosia looking to earn a livelihood through farming and grazing. And today they're being threatened by land confiscation.
We presented our case after we were evicted. We demanded our land back and presented the relevant paperwork confirming our ownership. And we convinced the court that this is Palestinian land. The decision of the Supreme Court of Justice was that it is indeed Palestinian land.
The fate of around 300 Palestinians who live here in Sosia is uncertain and remains under threat of eviction. Thousands of Palestinian children and their families who live in high-risk areas face that uncertain destiny, according to a study completed by the organization Save the Children while working in the Palestinian territories. The study uncovered the fact that forced migration threatens tens of thousands of Palestinian children and their families in some areas that are under the complete control of Israeli authorities in the West Bank and on the borderline in Gaza. 49% out of the 1,500 Palestinians living here were included in this study. Since the year 2000, they were forced to migrate at least once as a result of land confiscation to enable the construction of the separation wall and the settlements.
The residents of the region with the highest risk of eviction are the ones who are subjected to the worst conditions. They face extreme difficulties in reaching basic necessities, and around 50% of them are completely unable to reach essential services.
Israel has still not responded to the report, while the Palestinian Authority says the results are accurate.
The Palestinian Authority and the Palestinian people have the right to build in these areas, as they are vital for the eventual establishment of a Palestinian state. It is occupied Palestinian land, and even if these areas were specifically identified in the beginning of the transition agreement to be within the final solution, that doesn't mean that these lands are disputed or that they are Israeli.
Until this report's recommendations are applied, primitive life will remain inherent to the condition of these refugees. From Sousia, south of Hebron, Iman Erekat, BBC.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is in Paris today, where he is set to meet French President Nicolas Sarkozy in just over an hour. Iran is expected to top their talks. Netanyahu wanted to stop over in France before heading home from the U.S. in order to highlight the urgency of the matter. The Prime Minister is expected to urge Sarkozy to press harder on Tehran to freeze nuclear activities. Meanwhile, although it's been nearly 48 hours after Netanyahu met with U.S. President Barack Obama in Washington, questions still remain as to what exactly went on during their hour-and-a-half meeting. Opinions vary. Was the blackout imposed on the media due to bad feelings, or were the talks so sensitive that silence was golden for all involved? IBA's Ellie Waglanter fills us in on the details.
Monday night's meeting between Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and U.S. President Barack Obama has left many confused as to what actually happened between the two leaders. Were there tensions, or was it warm and congenial? During yesterday's meeting of the Jewish Federation's General Assembly, White House Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel gave no indication that there was any tension between the President and the Prime Minister. Emanuel stuck to the broad outline of how the Obama administration sees the peace process.
For it is only through dialogue that we can achieve lasting peace that Israel seeks. And perhaps more than at any time since Israel's conception, we have a President of the United States who is in a position to bridge divides that have proven for decades to be very treacherous to traverse.
Those left most confused as to what happened were members of the media covering Netanyahu's week in Washington, which included his own appearance at the General Assembly. So confused is the press that one newspaper reporter filed completely opposite stories between last night and today. First, we learned that PM offers Obama additional gestures to get Abbas on board in peace talks. And then 8 hours later, we read, Washington disappointed, Netanyahu didn't present concrete steps. Last May, when the two met, as shown here, there was plenty of media coverage. Now, nothing. But one man who was in the room with Netanyahu and Obama, National Security Advisor Uzi Arad, spoke with Israel Radio from Paris and laid out a different scenario than is being portrayed by the media. Arad said things were so friendly that the group of eight, four from each side, even cracked open beer bottles together. Talk is cheap, Arad pointed out. Look at the essence, not the wrappings. The lack of a media briefing, which was agreed upon by both sides, may become clear in the future, he said. But one media outlet, the Jewish Telegraphic Agency, focused on one sentence delivered by Emanuel.
No one should allow the issue of settlements to distract from the overarching goal of a lasting peace between Israel, Palestinians, and the Arab world.
That remark, wrote JTA, sounded almost exactly like Netanyahu's statement a day earlier, which led to this headline. Obama shifts into Israel's corner, but tries not to show it. The U.S. has adopted Israel's position on no settlement freeze before talks begin, wrote the JTA. But with the Obama administration trying to downplay that shift in positions, a high-profile meeting with the Israeli leader, followed by a joint news conference, could only have done Obama harm. So maybe the meeting between Obama and Netanyahu was really more friendly than anyone is letting on. Only time will tell.
In Lebanon, Hezbollah Secretary General Saeed Hassan Nasrallah says the whole Israeli army will be destroyed if it attacks Lebanon.
Send as much military contingencies as you want. 5, 7. Send all of the Israeli army if you want. We will destroy this army and crush this army in our valleys and in our villages.
Nasrallah says Lebanon will continue its fight against Israel's psychological war. He said the U.S. has fully committed itself to Israel's security and shattered the illusion of change it promised. Nasrallah said the new administration of President Barack Obama
has ignored Tel Aviv's violations of international law shown in the Goldstone report. He urged regional and Islamic countries to strengthen their ties and called for a united front against common enemies. Nasrallah believes resistance is the only way to protect the sovereignty and dignity of Lebanon and liberate the Palestinian people. He warned regional countries against conflicts being portrayed as sectarian divide, referring to the unrest in northern Yemen. Nasrallah made the comments on the occasion of Lebanon's Martyrs' Day.
After going through numerous difficulties to gain the necessary construction license, preparations for the opening of the biggest mosque in France in 2011 have begun in Marseille.
We are on the second floor of a building that has a large hall for praying, known as the Grand Marseille Mosque. There are more than 60 special venues for praying in the city, attracting more than 200,000 Muslims. For decades, all of them have been waiting for a real mosque to be built.
Every religious community has a special place for worshiping. What we are lacking in Marseille is a mosque worthy of its name.
We used to be forced to pray on the sidewalk. Having a mosque like this benefits society.
It will be considered one of the largest French mosques, with 6,000 square meters to welcome more than 7,000 believers. It will also have a school to teach the Quran, a library, and a restaurant open to all. 15 Muslim countries equally split the cost of 22 million euros required to build the mosque, and the building itself belongs to the municipality.
Was it not necessary to get a new place for Muslims in order to talk with other religions, have dialogue with each other, and explain what Islam is?
After a lengthy opposition, the Muslim community's request to build a mosque was warmly welcomed today.
I'm Catholic, but this doesn't prevent me from respecting all religions.
The important thing is to receive funds to start the construction work this spring in order to perform the first prayer in 2011.
The organization Culture for All hosted a festival in Anbar to highlight Iraqi talent and aspirations.
The festival witnessed heavy participation by cultural organizations and presented a wide variety of artistic and cultural events.
A cultural spark was lit by hosting the Culture for All Festival in coordination with the provinces of Rabat, Fallujah, and Al-Wahid and their cultural institutions. A variety of cultural and artistic exhibits were presented.
It is my honor and pleasure to stand here today in front of this select group of culture lovers and to add to it those who love the culture of creation. I say creation because you support its most important foundation, and that is the building of the soul through the heart. In turn, the integration of the two produces a civilization and not a rigid structure.
The Association of Culture for All organizes this event alongside writers, artists, and the province of Anbar. It is held for two successive days during which artistic and cultural events are held, and a shared cultural exhibition is presented. As you can see, the main goal is to build new cultural relationships.
The increased interest in these gatherings reflects the desire of these organizations to develop the aptitude and talent of all intellectuals.
A
Al-Zubair district in southern Basra is known for its wedding customs that are traced back to the Saudi city of Najd. One of these customs is the wedding celebration. Our reporter, Ali Khalaf, attended one of these weddings and reported on it.
Wedding celebrations in Al-Zubair are different from those in other parts of Iraq, perhaps because the man in charge of providing music at this wedding is Qassam Al-Rihani. He teaches old music and explains how the music at this wedding is very different. People attended the wedding as if they were part of the musical groups regardless of their age. The old, the young, and middle-aged all dance and sing. Sabah Abu al-Khair is a popular singer, especially when it comes to wedding parties. He's well known in all parts of Al-Zubair. You can find him in every single wedding, regardless of whether or not he has been invited.
The wedding at Al-Zubair is distinguished. For example, people in Basra do not celebrate weddings similarly. Differences can be seen in the wedding dresses, the candles, and the Baswani dance. Weddings in Basra are different. They do not have similar customs.
The Abu al-Khair musical group is financially dependent on the fees paid by people holding the wedding. The more money they are paid, the more members of the group perform.
If we get paid enough, then I can bring people who dance with sticks and swords and some others wearing a variety of costumes. But if we do not get enough money, then we can't bring all of them.
The groom did not stop dancing. He even convinced the police to dance along with him. However, they asked us not to show their faces on TV. The groom also started dancing more conservatively when we started to videotape him.
We have continuous musical celebrations for 1 week before the wedding. The celebration includes the Zafa and the Henna. Therefore, the Zubair wedding differs from that of Basra and Iraq in general.
The Zaffe, or showcasing the newlyweds in Zubair, is unique and no one performs it except the residents of Zubair. Without a doubt, this diverse city, which is 1400 years old, is very special and unique. From Al-Zubair district in Basra, Ali Khalaf Al-Arabiya.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.